love you. Don't care what they do, I will always love you. Let it pass me by, crying into the night for you.
We're going to hear a lot more from him tonight, and it's going to be a great show. Welcome to St. Patrick's Day Eve. All right? We're going to have a good time tonight. We're going to thank a lot of people for being here, so we got to get moving a little quicker than normal. So I'm not going to bog you down with a lot of boring details. But first, we've got to thank Rick and Val for opening up the place for us. Rick, Val, owners of Commerce Street Creamery. We are recording live here on Commerce Street in Centreville. It gives you a great opportunity to display your music, and so those of you to tell us a little bit about ourselves, get to know each other. We have Queen Anne's County Television here doing the recording, and I appreciate that. George, thank you very much. And so if anybody hasn't come down to see it or might be watching this later on at home, we do these on Thursday nights, once a month though. It's about enough, okay? It being St. Patrick's Day, and there's a lot of jokes about bars and Irishmen, there's a waterman that went to Ireland just recently on vacation. Walked into an Irish pub, and he says to the bartender, turns around and looks out to him, "I hear all you Irishmen can drink. Well, I got a bet for you." He says, "I'll give you $500. I'll line up 10 pints of Guinness, but you got to drink one right after the other." Everybody kind of looks at each other in the bar, and one fella even gets up and walks out. Evidently, he's got no challengers, so he sits up against the bar and he starts drinking. Half an hour goes by, this Irishman comes back in, the one that had left, been gone 30 minutes, says to, "Hey, is that bet still up?" And the guy says, "Well, yeah, it sure is." So the bartender lines up 10 pints of Guinness, and he proceeds to drink everyone right down to the end. The waterman hands him the $500, says, "I've never seen anything like it." And the Irishman looks at him and says, "Thank you very much." Waterman says, "Let me ask you a question. Where did you go for that 30 minutes?" "Well, I went down to the pub down the street, make sure I could do it." That's a good one. Yeah, right. We got to get you in the mood. Ed and Ethel every year go to the state fair. Every single year, Ed wants to ride in a helicopter. Ethel always says, $50 is $50. Well, Ed's getting a little frustrated now. They've been going to the same state fair for 50 years. Same helicopter pilot, incidentally, has been at the same state fair. So finally, it's Ed's 70th birthday. He says, "Ethel, I want to fly in the helicopter." Helicopter pilot says to him, "You know, she's been coming with you for 50 years, and every year you say $50 is $50, and you don't get a ride." He says, "Here's what I'm going to do, Ethel. I'm going to take you and your husband, and I'm going to put you in that helicopter, and I'm going to take you up and do all the tricks that I know how to do. And if you don't make one screech, one scream, one noise after I set this helicopter down, the ride's on me." Ethel looks at Ed, looks at the helicopter pilot, and says, "Get in, Ed." So Ed jumps in the helicopter, Ethel's in the helicopter, takes off, and he banks it left, and he banks it right, and he's coming in low, and he flips half over, and he lands it. And as that helicopter pilot's setting that helicopter down just ever so gently, he looks in the back, and he says, "Ed, I can't believe you didn't say anything." Ed says, "Well, after the first turn when Ethel flew out, I was, but $50 is $50. Irishman walks into another bar that goes on and on. These Irishmen are drinkers. So Irishman walks into another bar and he walks up to the bartender and says, "I'll have 3 Guinnesses." Gives him the Guinness. He goes and sits down in the back of the bar and he proceeds to drink. One drink, one sip, one sip, one sip. Rotate all the way around until he finishes all 3. Brings it back up to the bar. The bartender says, "You know, it's easier if you buy one, all right? And they last and taste better than buying all 3 and drinking them like that. Why don't you let me do it like that?" He says, "Oh, no, 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 no. I got a brother who lives in America. I got another brother who lives in Australia, and I live here in Ireland. And we promised the only way we would drink would be together, so that's how we have to do it." The bartender says, "That's fantastic custom. I think that's great." Goes on for 3 months. He keeps coming into the same pub. Keeps ordering the beers the same way. One time he comes in there, he says, "I'll just take 2. Well, the whole bar gets quiet. They don't know what's going on. And the bartender says, "You know, I don't want to pry, but I'm sorry for your loss." And the guy looks at him. He says, "Loss? Oh, I get it. Oh, no, everybody's fine. Everybody's okay. I just quit drinking." All right, so we have a great show tonight. We're going to learn how to make whiskey. For those who are a little thirsty, we're going to learn. We have Jan Withers and her husband here, past president and director of Mothers Against Drunk Driving. We have Thomas Walsh, who's going to do a little poetry reading for us. And we also have, of course, Rob Finecey. All right. And we'll wrap up the evening, of course, with the Black Knights. But I tell you what, I enjoyed his intro, so I think we should hear some more, don't you?
I'll do it.
He does, so we're going to hear some more. Let's do it.
I got my grandson. It's called "I Must Be Doing All Right." just you and me. Nowhere to be. Playing on this new guitar. You watch me sing. I'm feeling down without you around. Even though this world around me, it's looking down. But I've got this feeling I'm doing fine. You and me make it alright. Standing up so fast, making a little glass. Grinning from ear to ear, you start to dance. We can be down with you around. I bring to you la dee da. With the song of my kiss I sing to you la dee da. And when you laugh with me, and when you smile with me, we must be doing alright. Crawling oh so fast, breaking up your laugh, ringing for ear to ear, you watch me dance. I can be wrong with you alone, and when I know you're there, we sing this song. I'm doing fine, 'cause you and me make it alright. With the butterfly kiss I bring to you, lock it up. With your hands on the strings I sing to you, lock it up. And when you smile with me, and when you laugh with me, we must be doing alright.
Hey, yes, Jeff.
And when you smile with me, and when you laugh with me, we must be doing alright. We must be doing.
Wrote that song together. Everybody was pulling my guitar strings and dancing in front of me, so I wrote the song about it.
Well, that's really nice, Rob. Thank you very much for bringing that to us. That's appreciated. Ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great pleasure to welcome to the stage Jonathan Cook, owner of Centreville Blackwater Distilling, located on Kent Island. Tell us about whiskey.
Absolutely. So I'm John Cook, and I'm the Chief Operating Officer of Blackwater Distilling. We are located in Stevensville, so we are right off of Route 8. Just get a couple things about us out of the way up front before we start talking about spirits a little bit. Blackwater Distilling's been open now for almost 6 years. Our sixth anniversary will be this April, so that makes us the oldest and longest operating distillery in the state of Maryland, believe it or not.
Wow.
We were the first distillery to open in the state since the early 1970s, so that was when the last one had closed. Maryland traditionally is a state that had focused on rye whiskey production. When we came into being, we focused first off on vodka. So today we've expanded from our first vodka. We've got four vodkas on the market today. We've got four rums and we have one whiskey. So I want to talk a little bit about how spirits in general are made. And since it's the day before St. Patrick's Day, I thought it would be a good idea then to focus a little bit about
whiskey. Well, I got to take notes because I got to have something to drink by the end of the day. So go ahead and
speak slowly, all right?
Okay. So a lot of people understand kind of intuitively how beer and wine are made. And it's a little bit different for spirits, but there's a lot of things in common. The fermentation process is the biggest thing that these two have in common. And basically, when you're distilling a spirit, what you're doing is you're boiling something that's already been fermented. So whether you're talking about beer, wine, or spirits, you're starting with either a sugar or a starch source. If you start with a starch, it's going to be something like a grain. So if you're making whiskey, if you're making beer, you're going to start with a starch. Hmm. And then the trick is converting that starch into a sugar. So whatever you're doing, you're trying to get it into a sugar before you introduce yeast. Fermentation is the process that creates alcohol, so that's the part we all want to know about. When you're making a spirit, so if it's beer or wine, you're going to actually drink that fermentation. So wine is just fermented grapes, beer is fermented grain. When you're making spirits, you're going to do one more step, and basically what you're doing is you're boiling it. So you're going to boil the alcohol out of that fermentation. So distillation by itself doesn't create any alcohol, it just purifies all the alcohol that's already in that fermentation. So that doesn't sound like a whole lot of fun so far.
No,
when's
it all get back in there, the part that I like?
So that's after you get through distillation, that's when it starts to get fun again.
Okay,
so,
good.
So when you come off the still, everything that comes out is going to be clear, regardless of what it looks like when you drink it. It's going to be super high proof, so it'll be somewhere between 160 and 185 proof, somewhere in there for everything we make. That's really what begins to differentiate different products. So the higher the proof when it comes off the still, the more likely it is to be neutral, the more it's going to taste like a vodka. The lower the proof coming off the still, the more flavor you're going to have in it, the better it's going to perform in a barrel. So that kind of brings us to products like whiskey. Also products like gin are going to be distilled to a lower proof because you need some of the impurities to really bind with the flavors in there. So with whiskey in particular, you're going to not go more than 80% alcohol. And honestly, when we barrel, we're barreling in the 130 to 140 proof range. So in between 65 and 70% alcohol. And it's what happens in that barrel that really makes whiskey special.
Hmm.
So the things that give whiskey its flavor is a combination of barrel aging. So what kind of barrel it is, how long it ages, whether you decide to finish it in something fancy like a porter or sherry cask. But also what goes into the spirit, so what kind of grain goes in there to begin with. And a really good example is comparing with American whiskey, things we're all familiar with. If you compare like a bourbon and a rye, you can tell there's a big difference between the two, and that's all based on the grain that you're fermenting and distilling. So rye has a spicier, hotter flavor to it naturally. Bourbon has to be a minimum of 51% corn, which is sweeter all by itself. So playing with the composition of that mash bill and then how you age the spirit in the barrel, how long it ages, what the environment is it ages in, is really going to be what dictates how it tastes at the end of the day. Looking at Irish whiskey in particular, there's a couple unique things. So once you get into the UK, your two big whiskeys are going to be Irish and obviously Scotch whiskey. Some big differences between the two. Lots of Scotches are single malts. And that means basically they are one single type of grain that's malted, and typically that's going to be smoked over a peat fire. So that's how you get peaty Scotches. But with Irish whiskey in particular, you're going to have something that's distilled to a higher proof. It's going to be something that is, they call it mellowing over charcoal, which is basically a very light filtration. And those two things are going to help it to be a milder whiskey. So it's a little bit more approachable as a category than some of the heavily peated Scotches. And we see Irish whiskey really picking up in terms of popularity quite a bit in the last couple of years.
All right.
I think that's a quick primer on spirits.
So how long does it stay in a cask or a barrel? How long does it stay in there?
So that's my favorite part about barrel aging. It's the only part of this business that nobody can hold me accountable for on a calendar.
Oh, I see.
It sits in that barrel until it is done.
And you're the only one that knows when it's done.
Well, yeah, me and one or two other guys.
This is the secret, see? Over there on Kent Island, it's in the business part.
It is.
Right?
Yep, so just north on
Do you have a big warehouse where you you walk in there and there's barrels all over the place, or is it a little bit smaller operation that?
So a little bit of both.
Okay.
We are trying to get as many barrels accumulating in there as possible.
Okay.
It's not floor to ceiling yet. It's not what you expect from a Jack Daniels. We got about 5,000 square feet up there.
Okay.
We are open 7 days a week for tours.
That helps.
From 12 to 5, so we're trying to get as many people from the community in as possible,
right,
too.
Do you have classes or anything you offer? Have people make their own or anything like that?
So we don't do classes because, right, you know, sadly it's still illegal to distill at home.
Oh shoot.
not so sadly if you own a distillery.
I guess it's not.
But
well, people make wine at home,
yeah,
and make beer at home.
Yeah, the federal government gets picky when you're distilling, which is kind of funny. But we do offer sort of limited, more experiential-based projects. So we've got whiskey projects we've done. We're doing a rum project right now. We're taking a really distinct approach to how we're aging the rum. It's called a Solera, which is pretty cool by itself. But we do that almost from a crowdfunding perspective. So we sell shares into the program, and that allows people to kind of be involved with it over the whole maturation of the product. They get bottles at different points during its aging and allows them to experience the aging of that product.
So is it all under the Betty Boop label, or is it something? I said that wrong, didn't
I? Yeah, you sure did.
Well, that's why you're here, to keep me on track, all right?
So all the vodkas are Sloop Betty.
Sloop Betty, Sloop thank
Betty.
You.
And the rum brand is called Picaroon, so it's P-I-C-A-R-O-O-N.
Okay.
That's an archaic word for a rogue or a scoundrel.
Okay.
And the whiskeys have been kind of smaller release whiskeys so far. So we don't really have a single brand behind those.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, the whiskeys we're doing are what we're calling a finishing barrel series.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a traditional Maryland rye mash bill that we're just aging in different types of barrels. So
is that in the stores yet? I mean,
it is.
Okay.
So the first release is definitely out for retail distribution, and that's the rye that's been aged in a sherry cask. So that's a PX sherry. Which is Pedro Jimenez.
Yeah. He and I were friends in college. Keep going.
Yeah. The second release just is got a couple bottles that have been filled. We're filling the rest of them this weekend, and that is that same spirit. It's aged for another 3 or 4 months in a Napa port cask.
So if I'm out in California, am I able to see some of your products as well?
So
or are you that big?
We are not that big.
Okay.
We are distributed.
So let's narrow it down.
So, so we're distributed primarily in Maryland. We're also in D.C. So everything that we produce is available in both Maryland and D.C. Our wholesaler is Republic National. So if you know a bar or a restaurant you'd like to see us in, I do like to tell people that you are our best salesperson because you are the one who intends to purchase it.
Right. Yeah. I think that was called push or pull marketing. I can't remember which.
Yeah.
But that does.
A little bit of both.
Yeah, a little bit of both. That's right. So where can we purchase some of your products? So here locally.
So locally in Centreville, we're in Centreville Liquors, we're in Drapers, we're in Hillside.
Okay.
If you get out a little bit further, I mean, Queen Anne's County, we're pretty well represented.
Okay.
I'm sure almost every store on Kent Island we're in, we're pretty well represented in Easton and in Chestertown too. And if they don't see us, they can get us in.
So how big is a barrel that ages in?
It depends on what you're aging.
Okay.
So
I'm curious as how many bottles you can get out of a barrel, but if each barrel is different, I can't answer that question.
Yeah, everybody always asks me about math.
Yeah. That's always been a stumbler for me.
So the traditional whiskey barrel is a 53-gallon barrel.
Okay.
A lot of people today use little barrels, thinking it'll speed the process up, but there's always a casualty.
Yeah,
The spirit's almost never as well matured, so it's always going to be hotter coming out of a small barrel than you want it to be. That's the one. You know, good side, bad side with whiskey is you have to be patient.
So when you go on a tour, you walk through, see these barrels, see some bottles being filled up.
If you're real lucky, you can see us distilling that day, too.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. All right. Yeah. All right. And then maybe a little sample at the end or something?
We do a tasting at the end. Absolutely.
That's
it's all part of the package. So you get to go through and learn about everything we do.
Got to have motivation.
Yeah.
Right?
It's the light at the end of the tunnel is the tasting bar.
Right. So the products, the ryes and the things that you use in your whiskey and all your other liquors, do you buy those locally or where do you get those from? Are they from local farmers?
We buy everything that we can locally.
Okay.
We surprisingly can't buy a whole lot, even in Maryland. You know, things like rum, obviously.
Right.
We don't grow sugar cane.
Yeah, I haven't seen a whole lot on the side of the road.
So we don't have a lot of choice there.
Okay.
But whatever we can, we do.
Okay, good. Great. So have you won any awards? Not to put you on the spot. I have no idea. But
you asked a great question. We are actually the most awarded distillery in the state. It doesn't sound like a lot because I started.
Thank you. You know how many awards I've won?
How many?
This many.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, so you're doing well.
I just give it time.
Okay. So you've won some awards for all your spirits as a company in general, or what?
So we try to compete our spirits as much as possible. The traditional vodka has been out the longest, so we've had more
opportunity. Yeah, that's the one I remember the most of. Anyway.
Yeah, so we've got our...
I don't remember the name right, but I remember... I was close.
So Sloop Betty as a product has 3 gold medals and the Best in Show.
Okay.
And we try to compete in the bigger competitions as much as possible. So the Best in Show is actually the New York World Wine and Spirits Competition.
Oh, wow. Well, that's pretty prestigious.
One. Yeah. So we've just, our most recent award was for the Overproof Rum, which won a silver, which is still quite good.
Yeah, I would say so.
Yeah.
So there's not a whole lot of heady after
there
that.
There isn't.
No, there's just one.
Just one. Well, it depends on the competition.
So you're open 7 days a week for tours.
7 days
so
a week.
So we can all go down there. We'll get a bus.
Yep.
We'll
sounds good to me.
And we'll go on down there.
We can help.
All right. Thank you very much for coming, Jonathan.
Thanks
I appreciate you coming and sharing your industry with us. I knew nothing about it before you got here, and now I have too many questions I want to ask, so
fantastic.
It's probably best we part at this point, right?
Thanks a lot.
I think that...
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I think that you would get some really good awards if you made an Irish whiskey stronger than Scottish whiskey.
Give us some time.
All right.
Rob, how about more music here? Something get us in the mood. All right?
Oh, you gotta read, huh?
Nah, I'm just gotta like look at my fingers too.
Last time to be in love.
time to be in love.
Emcee for the evening. My name is Steve Hazzard, and I am located in downtown Centreville at Commerce Street Creamery on Commerce. We are recording here live in front of a studio audience with Queen Anne's County Television, Channel 7, for those of you who don't know. So we've had a lot of guests so far, and we've got a few more to go. My next guest, I am proud to introduce, is Mr. Thomas Walsh. Let me tell you a little bit about Tom. Tom here was born in suburban Boston, lived here for 10 years, then upstate New York, then Chicago, went to college and medical school in Chicago, came here to the University of Maryland to do his family practice, training, and never left. 18 years residence of Queenstown. Family doctor and MD primary care in Queenstown near the ER, enjoys cooking, gardening, bookkeeping, community events, and a former Queen Anne's County Orphans Court judge. I'm a second generation Irish American and have dual citizenship, USA and Republic of Ireland. It gives me great pleasure to introduce to all of us Thomas Walsh. Dr. Thomas Walsh.
It's okay, not right now.
Well, you have some prepared things you want to read?
Yeah, okay. I thought what I'd like to do is do a little bit of storytelling, a little bit of history of Ireland, a little bit of a tour of Ireland, and a little bit of fun, all in just a few minutes. So let me see if I can accomplish that. I'm not really a storyteller, but I think I can make it happen tonight. So I got the opportunity to do this, and a good friend of mine lent me a book. It said 1,000 years of Irish poetry. So I have to admit, Fred, I didn't read it from cover to cover. But in the 1,000 years that Irish people have been writing poems, I don't think they wrote very many fun poems. It's kind of a lot of stories about tragic things that have happened. But I tried to find some things that would lighten this up a little bit. So let me tell you a little bit about myself. My grandparents on my father's side came from Ireland in the early 1900s. My grandmother, who was from a little town named Skull outside of Skibbereen in the southwest of Ireland, used to tell me stories about her when she was growing up. And she left Ireland in the, I suppose it was around 1916, so it was before the Irish War of Independence, so they were still under the rule of the British when she left. And there was some really rough times. She lived on the ocean, and she told me that they used to go out in boats and get lobster. But because of the British rule, they weren't allowed to eat the lobster. But she told me they were allowed to eat the dead ones. And so any lobster that died during the lobstering, they were allowed to keep. And she told me a lot of other sad stories. She wasn't the kind of person that you would like want to, she wouldn't come up to me and hug me. I think that was part of her upbringing. She was a kind of a cold and dismal life that she had, even after she came here. But anyway, she was a loving person. I found a poem that reminded me of her, and I wanted to share that with you first. So one more thing I want to tell you. There's a during the British rule of Ireland, the Irish people were not allowed to speak Irish or Gaelic, as most of us know it. But there were some regions in Ireland, and they're called the Gaeltacht, and it's the areas of Ireland where people still spoke Irish and kind of refused to obey the British rule that they couldn't speak Irish. So Skibbereen and Skull, and in the north of Ireland, not Northern Ireland, but the northwest part of Ireland up near Galway, there's still a really hardcore Irish-speaking area there. So anyway, let me start with this. This is a poem by a man named Michael Harnett. Michael Harnett's a contemporary poet. He lived from the 1940s and he passed away in 1999. And the name of the poem is Death of an Irish Woman. Sorry if I get choked up. Some of this stuff makes me emotional. But anyway, let me start with this poem. Ignorant in the sense that she ate monotonous food and thought the world was flat, and pagan in the sense that she knew that things moved all night and they were neither dogs or cats, but hobgoblin and dark-faced men, she nevertheless had fierce pride. But sentenced in the end to eat thin, diminishing porridge in a stone-cold kitchen, she clenched her brittle hands around a world that she could not understand. I loved her from the day she died. She was a song that nobody sings. She was a house ransacked by soldiers. She was a language seldom spoken. She was a child's purse full of useless things. I know that sounds really sad. Sorry about that. I started on the sad note, but you know, it reminded me of my grandmother. She had that kind of cold but loving attitude, and that poem really captured that really well. So now I want to take you on a little tour. We're going to go from Skibbereen in the southwest, and we're going to go up north of Galway on the west, the northwest part of Ireland. If you get just north of Galway, I don't know how many of you have been there, but north of Galway is an area called Connemara. Connemara is a really desolate, cold, stony, kind of scary place on the ocean. A lot of Irish people during the British rule were banished to Connemara because it was a place where the British didn't want. I mean, it wasn't the lush farms of the Midlands in Ireland. It was the place where nobody wanted to live. In fact, Oliver Cromwell, when he was ransacking Ireland, one of his generals described Connemara, and he described it by saying, "There's not enough wood to hang a man, not enough water to drown him, and not enough dirt to bury him." So that was kind of what Connemara was like. But anyway, to lighten things up, I thought I'd intersperse a few quotes by Oscar Wilde, because he is always fun. So Oscar Wilde made a little quote where he said, "To disagree with three-fourths of the British public is one of the first requisites of sanity." So anyway. So this poem, Connemara, was written by a man named Thomas Horton, and I'll read you this. "West of Galway lies a land scorched by the chill of northern winds, where ancient hills stoically contemplate their gray reflections in dark, misty lakes. Rolling storm clouds serve as the canvas for monochromatic panorama that lulls the local folk into an inescapable monotony, their lilting language itself a murmur that recalls the falling rain. The plodding passage of days in this dreary, silent landscape is a hell all its own for those accustomed to urban bustle. But the ginger natives of this gray land sing bright, Kaylee songs, drink their lager by golden firelight, dance reels and jigs, and tell stories of a time when giants roamed the hillocks and heroes sailed the roaring seas in search of mythic monsters. Descendant from hardy stock of shepherds and saints, these rustic people regard their old ways as new, discover their future through their past, and are never bored as long as there's a tale to be told, a smile to take in, or a pint to share with a friend. Children of the Gaeltic, sing your rowdy songs. Remind me once again of that night in Ballyconley when I was one of you, the night that turned me Irish." I've been in those pubs, and that's what happens, of what I can remember, but yeah. Anyway, so during the 1800s and the early 1900s, like I said, Ireland was ruled by the British, and it was a really sad, horrible time for the Irish. They weren't able to keep the goods that they produced, either from fishing or from farming. They weren't allowed to speak their language. They weren't allowed to practice their religion. Most Irish were Roman Catholics. And so it was a rough time. So there was an organization called the Irish Brotherhood, and the Irish Brotherhood was the beginning of what became the Irish Republican Army, or the IRA. not the IRA that blows up cars now, but the original IRA. And so just before World War II, I mean before World War I, the Irish Brotherhood started to meet, and they started to realize that they had an opportunity with this the outbreak of the First World War, and so many of the British soldiers were occupied in fighting a war in Europe, that maybe this might be an opportunity for them to finally have an uprising that might be successful. The uprisings had been so unsuccessful in the past, there wasn't a lot of public enthusiasm for another uprising. You know, lots of people died and things got burned down and it was kind of rough, but the Irish Brotherhood got together and they decided that right after Easter in 1916, they would try again. I'm sorry, this poem really makes me sad. But anyway, a poet that we all know, William Yeats, wrote this poem called Easter 1916. I've met them at the close of day, coming with vivid faces from counter or desk among the gray 18th century houses. I have passed with a nod of the head or a polite, meaningless word, or have lingered a while and said polite, meaningless words, and thought before I had done of a mocking tale or gibe to please a companion around a fire at the club, being certain that they and I but lived where motley is worn. All changed, utterly changed, a terrible beauty is born. The woman's days were spent in ignorant goodwill, her night is argument until her voice grew shrill. What voice more sweet than hers? When young and beautiful, she rode to harriers. This man had kept a school and rode our winged horse. This other and his helper and friend were coming into his force. He might have won fame in the end, so sensitive his nature seemed, so daring and sweet his thought, the other man had dreamed, a drunken, vainglorious lout. He had done most bitter wrong to some who are near my heart, yet I number him in my song. He too had resigned his part in the casual comedy. He too had been changed in his turn, transformed utterly. A terrible beauty is born. Hearts with one purpose through summer and winter seem enchanted to a stone to trouble their living stream. The horse that comes from the road, the rider, the birds that range from cloud to tumbling cloud, minute by minute they change. A shadow of cloud on the stream changed minute by minute. The horse hoofs slide on the brim and the horse plashes within it. A long-legged moor hens dive and the hens to moorcocks call. Minute by minute they live, the stone in the midst of it all. Too long a sacrifice can make a stone of the heart. Oh, when may it suffice? That is heaven's part, our part, to murmur upon name. As mother names her child, when sleep at last comes on the limbs that run wild. But what is this nightfall? No, no, not night, but death. Was it needless death after all? For England may keep faith for all that is done and said. We know their dream enough to know they dreamed and are dead. And what if excess love bewildered them till they died? I write it out in verse, McDonough and McBride and Conley and Pierce. Now, in time to be, wherever green is worn, are changed, changed utterly. A terrible beauty is born. So, after the uprising in 1916, it was a mess in Dublin, and the British, of course, were kind of pissed off about what happened, and so they rounded up and arrested several hundred people. But 15 of those people were sentenced to death. They were not necessarily people that were involved in the uprising either. Some of these people were from little towns outside of Dublin, but the British considered them organizers of the uprising, and they brought them to this place called Kilmainham Jail. And over the next 2 weeks, without a public trial and without defense, they executed those 15 people. So it really stirred up the Irish, and it was although the uprising was a failure, it stirred up enough in the Irish people that they said, we're not going to let this happen again. And shortly after that, the Irish War of Independence began,
and Ireland did become the Irish Free State in the early 1920s. So I guess the uprising of 1916 did lead to a free Ireland. So anyway, it was, in all, it was worth it, I guess. So I have one more story for you, and this is a little lighter. So anyway, there's a refrain that people use in Ireland. It's called, a pint of plain is your only man. And that expression means, it's a famous quotation that means, a pint of stout will solve all your problems. I know I've tried that, and it's worked some of the time, I guess. Anyway, I want to read you this little poem, and the name of the poem is A Workman's Friend. When things go wrong and will not come right, though you do your best you can, when life looks black in the hour of night, a pint of plain is your only man. When money's tight and hard to get, and your horse has also ran, and when all you have is a heap of debt, a pint of plain is your only man. When health is bad and your feelings feel strange and your face is pale and wan, the doctor says you need a change. A pint of plain is your only man. When food is scarce and your larder bare and no rashers grease your pan, when hunger grows as your meals are rare, a pint of plain is your only man. In time of trouble and lousy strife, you have still got darlin' plan. You can still turn to a brighter life. A pint of plain is your only man. Well, anyway, there we go.
You did it.
Yeah, that was fun.
Have you written any of your own poetry?
Oh, I've never written any poetry. I like reading poetry,
right.
And I learned a lot by preparing for this, and
right.
I enjoy it. Yeah.
Yeah.
I especially, you know, the lighter side of things in Irish literature is probably Oscar Wilde.
Yeah.
And I enjoy reading his quotations. Sometimes just for fun, I pull up Oscar Wilde quotations on my computer and read them for 15 or 20 minutes.
Admirable.
And
well, you mentioned you do beekeeping.
Oh, beekeeping, yeah, that's
yes.
My other hobby.
I mean, you harvest honey then, I presume, right?
I do. I've been a beekeeper for about 10, 12 years now. First few years were pretty dismal. I was kind of learning.
Yeah.
And
The bees weren't cooperating,
oh,
okay,
right. But all of a sudden, it all clicked, and probably for the last 8 years or so, I've been harvesting honey every year.
You get a lot? You sell it?
I get a lot.
Personal use.
And I don't really want to sell it because I don't want to be in the business of selling it. So right now, I'm kind of drowning in honey. If anybody wants any, let me know.
Well, that's good. Yeah, that's good.
But the beekeeping's been fun. You know, I learned a lot. The bees are amazing little animals, and it's just...
You get stung a lot?
I get stung a lot.
Yeah?
Yeah. When I took my beekeeping class, one of the days we had this, the name of the title of the class was Union Rules. And I thought that was kind of a funny name for that. But what the teacher was telling us is, these are the rules, you break the rules and you get stung.
Okay.
So every time I've gotten stung, I broke the rules.
Yeah. So it was your fault?
It was my fault.
Oh, well,
yeah.
Okay. So Ireland, you spend a lot. Do you get to go back quite frequently?
Yeah, I've been there several times, and I was back there last late June.
Uh-huh.
I mean, the late May, early June last year.
Right,
it was fun.
Do you go annually then?
Lately, I have been. Yeah,
yeah.
It was a big. I used to go a lot back in the 70s because my parents were living in England,
mm-hmm.
and then I had a lapse, I guess, when I was, you know, doing my life thing, getting my practice started,
right.
And all that. But in the past 3 or 4 years, I've probably gone back every year.
What kind of medicine do you practice?
Family practice.
Oh, just family practice? Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Well, just. I mean, that's
yeah, right.
You're right. That's keeping
no,
you busy.
I understand. That's not the first time someone said
yeah,
that.
Yeah. I'll embarrass you some more before the day's out. Hang on.
Yeah, right. I know. There's more to come.
There's more to come. Well, that's great. Now, let me ask you something. How do you compare Ireland and your visits to Ireland and the Eastern Shore of Maryland? How are they the same, or how are they different?
You know, in a lot of ways, most of Ireland, except for Dublin
mm-hmm.
and Cork City, and maybe to a small extent Galway, are rural farming communities.
Right.
And it's a lot like the Eastern Shore. And when you get into the West Coast, it gets, you know, rocky and, I mean, spectacular scenery, but most of the center of Ireland looks a lot. I mean, you could close your eyes and drive through the Eastern Shore of Maryland, and it would look similar. You know, lots of farms and... you know, how, you know, spread apart houses and all that.
Retirement. You're going to go there or you're going to stay here, you think?
I'll probably stay here, but keep going over there.
Keep going with some more regularity, right?
Yeah.
Okay, good deal. Well, you participated in the other community events, it said in your bio. What other community events do you do?
Oh, well, last November, I got kind of roped into that dance contest over on Ken Island.
Yeah?
Okay. I'm the guy that can't say no, you know, somebody...
I thought it was a girl that couldn't say it, but anyway, go ahead.
I'm the other half of that story.
Okay, I got it.
So, I'm the guy that can't say no. So, somebody asked me if I would participate in that Dancing for the Future.
Yeah.
So, it was funny. The lady came and talked to me in my office, and she's telling me all about this project and how they raise money for the schools and all that.
Right.
So I'm listening to her, and then I guess all of a sudden it clicked, and I said, "You're not asking me to become a contestant, are you?" And she said, "Well, actually, yes."
Oh boy.
And I said, "Apparently, you've never been to a Walsh wedding."
Yeah.
And she said, "What do you mean by that?" I said, "We don't dance at weddings. We all just stand around and drink. It's a big old Irish family, but we just stand around and drink. We don't dance." She said, "You'll be fine."
So, well, how'd you do?
I actually got first place.
Oh, yeah. First, like of the Irish, right?
Yeah, it was. It was two first place trophies. It was a People's Choice and the Judge's Choice. And me and my partner, Aaron, we won the People's Choice first place.
Fantastic. So, it's displayed in prominence on the altar, right? Is there a kneeler so you can look at it every day?
What's that?
Your trophy.
Oh, yeah, I have the trophy right in my living room. I look at it every day. It's a little mirror ball trophy.
Right.
I'm thinking, yep, that's the last time I didn't say no.
Right. Thomas, I thank you for coming and sharing your poetry with us.
Oh,
I appreciate it.
Okay.
And everyone, Thomas Walsh, thank you.
For you. And
called One Day Sunday.
Well, we are celebrating St. Patrick's Day, St. Patrick's Day Eve here at the Creamery in Centreville. And courtesy of Val and Rick Colby opening up their place for us for the special event. And it's been joyous so far. You know, St. Patrick's Day is the only day that everybody's Irish, right?
That's right.
Yeah, everybody's Irish. Oh, yeah? Well, I'm sure you are, with Finecey as the last name. How many people are Irish here in the audience today? This will prove a point. Yeah, just about, about all of us, right?
Okay.
Right. Well, very good, very good. Our next guest, Jan Withers and her husband. Jan was a past national president of Mothers Against Drunk Driving from the years 2011 and 2014. Both Joe, her husband, and Jan still volunteer with the group and making inroads there. I was not aware that that my producer was so fond of Fox News. Well, it's fair and balanced. We've talked about whiskey, and now we're going to talk about being safe when we drink. So, with that, Miss Jan Withers and her husband, Joe. How are you?
Good, thanks.
Good. Joe, here, take this. Wow. Kind of hold it. Well, you know, size isn't everything. Anyway, how are you?
We're doing great, thank you.
Okay. So I just got to speak with you a little bit beforehand, and not familiar with the, exactly how one becomes involved with Mothers Against Drunk Driving. Would you like to share that story with us? How does someone get involved?
Well, you know, people get involved in many different ways, but we got involved because our daughter was killed by a drunk driver. And, you know, what's interesting is my perception of MAD at that time was that we were out to prevent drunk driving. And we're very active in doing everything that they could do to prevent. Well, after our daughter was killed, her name is Alyssa, and she was 15 years old. And I was broken. I was just flattened. And a friend of mine, several months into it, she came over and she said, "Well, Jan, why don't you call MAD?" And I said, "I can't call MAD. I can't even get off the couch, out of bed, let alone be active like that." And she said, "No, maybe they can help you." So I picked up the phone and called MAD, and I tell you, not only did I get help, I was given hope again. And what I didn't know about MAD is that it has one of the largest victim services. It is the largest victim services organization in America. And that's my passion now, is to help other people, like they reached out their hand and helped me. And I really give MAD credit for being vertical again.
How long ago was this loss?
That was about 24 years ago, 24 or 5 years, yeah, almost 25 years ago. You know, you move forward. You
right.
don't move on.
No.
You move forward
right.
with a new...
Joe, you walked around showing a picture of your beautiful daughter on that button.
Is that what you did?
Okay. Yeah, I think I saw him doing that.
I did. And from when I... And my story is the same as Jen's. Obviously, we were lost, and we sort of... This is one of the ways we found ourselves. But for me, anyway, whenever I do anything with MAD, it's a way that I connect with my daughter that I can't connect by going home and seeing her. Because that's the hole that you have in your life. So I usually put a picture on it. I like to share with everybody, and that makes me feel more comfortable and closer to her.
Oh, that's wonderful. Taking a horrible situation and creating opportunities for others to move through. I think that's really, I'll tell you what, my heartstrings were plucked when I heard you telling me the story, not really understanding or knowing from a distance of what MAD does and represents. I had no idea.
Yeah.
So do you have regular, when you were a president, you were all across the country then?
All across the country. The national president of MAD, it's a term limit, it's a 3-year term. But in that position, you are the face of MAD,
mm-hmm.
and you don't run MAD, that's just CEO.
Oh,
but
okay.
The president is the face of MAD, and so travel all across the country and sometimes in other countries. I would give speeches day in and day out and being interviewed, but my favorite part of traveling around was being connected to other people who have been victimized.
Mm-hmm.
And there's something about, I remember this in the beginning when I watched the national president back then giving a talk, and I thought, okay, I want to get there someday. Not that I wanted to be president,
right.
but she had an aura about her, a peace that I thought, okay, if she can do that, then I can get there, you know.
And unfortunately, the prerequisite for being a president or being on the board, is that a case?
No, just being president.
You told me earlier.
Just a president.
Just president. You have to have had experience something like this.
That's true. That's very true.
Yeah, that's a tough
one. The face of the victims.
So have you, with all those travels that you were doing with Matt, did you meet some interesting people, in different walks of life, presidents of the United States, vice president, anything of that nature?
Actually, I did meet, I have a great story.
I want to hear it.
This was before I was president. This was back in, it was in 2000, wasn't it? The late 1990s. We were working back then to lower the blood alcohol concentration from the illegal limit from a 0.10 for driving down to a 0.08. By the way, I want to intersperse right now, as I think about it, because I forget sometimes, people need to know that MAD is not a bunch of angry people going around. We're not prohibitionists. We don't believe in not drinking, you know. We truly believe that we want people to drive safely. So we want people to decide how to go home with a designated sober driver and decide that before you ever go out. It's not about not drinking, it's about being safe. So anyway, so back in the late 1990s, we were working to get the blood alcohol concentration lowered because fewer people then get killed at that lower blood alcohol concentration. And it was passed nationally at the end of 1990s. And so President Clinton was the president at the time, and I was active in speaking all the time because our daughter was killed by a drunk driver who was at the 0.08 level, see?
He was right on the
road. Yeah, he was right there, and so he was an example. So as a result, when it passed, a few of the people in MAD were invited to stand in the Rose Garden when President Clinton announced, and he was signing the bill. So I am, as a result of being victimized, I have become a certified victim advocate. And I was attending court. We lived in Upper Marlboro at the time. And I was attending court with this family who was particularly fragile. And they were so heartbroken. And it was a really rough time for them. And so our public policy person called. She said, Jan, do you want to go to the Rose Garden? And I said, you know, really, it's OK. I need to be with this family. I've been at the White House, and it's okay. And she goes, but Jan, you get to stand in the Rose Garden. I said, it's okay. You know, I really need to be with them. They need the support. And then she said, Jan, it's going to be first thing at 8:30 in the morning, and you can get back to court. Right. I went, oh, okay. Yeah, I'll do it. So we go, and we go into the West Wing, and then we go into the Roosevelt Room, and we're sitting waiting. And I'm thinking we're waiting to go out into the Rose Garden. And after a while, we're called out. There's about 7-8 of us. Mm-hmm. And we're called to go out in the Rose Garden. And we do not go into the Rose Garden. We go into the Oval Office.
Oh, wow.
It was so cool. So cool. I go, oh my gosh, I'm really in the Oval Office. And so then President Clinton did come in. And he signed the bill. And of course, when they sign the bill, they have all these pens laid out.
Right.
And so you each are handed a pen as a result of that. That was cool.
Were you with her? Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, I was in the Rose Garden. I didn't get to go.
You're out there waiting, looking at your watch, holding an umbrella, right?
And it's President Clinton, for God's sake. The other thing I would point out is that MAD has a really close relationship with the NFL. And
that's true.
Because they have a lot of problems with the players, as you see in the paper.
Yeah, I've read a couple articles.
Yeah,
negative
yeah,
there.
Yeah. So they asked us to team with them, and Jan has been to many of the camps to meet with the rookies.
Right.
And so she knows more football players than I do. But she watches the football games now because she sees people that she actually met.
Hey, it's a win-win for you, Joe.
It's a win-win for me.
My personal best friend. I mean, I don't really.
So you all live here now locally.
Yes, we do.
And you're still volunteering, but you're not doing the presidential duties then, right?
Right.
Where do you live here?
We live in Symphony Village in Centreville. Yeah.
How long have you been here?
Since May.
Oh, so you're newbies.
We're newbies and we love being here.
All right. And prior to that, of course, you lived across the bridge.
We did. We lived in Upper Marlboro.
Upper Marlboro, you said that, yeah. Joe, what did you do professionally before?
30 years in the Navy, 20 years working for the Secretary of Defense.
So oh, okay.
I chase Russian submarines.
Oh, did you?
Yeah.
Well, there's been a lot of talk of that Russian issue now, so they might be able to use you. I don't know.
I could get called back, I guess. But it actually raises an interesting point, and to reiterate something Jan said in the beginning, obviously 30 years in the Navy as a pilot, I've been to my share of happy hours. And,
you're right.
And I remember many times that I probably should not have been driving home. And the message is not to go enjoy a happy hour, but the message is to make sure before you go that you have a way to get home.
Safely.
Because you got to get home safe, and that's what this is about. And with the advent of things like Uber, there's just not a reason why you can't have a plan for that. No. Just don't wait to make the decision after you already started drinking. Figure that out before you get there.
Yeah.
Well, it's I tell you what, you folks, your attitude is incredible. You present the mad in a wonderful light, if that could be such a thing.
It's a good
and I'm very impressed with the way you handle it. I would be distraught, and I would definitely need your services and want them. So God forbid something like that would ever happen. I appreciate you coming to see us, and I appreciate the work that you've done in the past, and you'll continue to do, because I think it benefits every one of us in this country, and I appreciate your efforts. Thank you very, very much for coming.
Thank you so much.
Thank
you. You got it. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for coming. Let's hear something, Rob. Whoa.
Thank you.
This don't belong. I've got this crying feeling that you are wrong. Lucinda, where did you go? Lucinda, why don't say goodbye? Cause I know that it's hard, don't get me wrong. Oh, no, no, Lucinda, no, where did you go? Lucinda, why is this goodbye? And I know that it's hard, don't get me wrong. My friends all say,
well, we've listened to him play all evening. Robert Finecey, who has been a professional musician and vocalist for over 35 years. He's played in such bands as Expedition, Archangel, Hyde Park, Silver Queen, Appaloosa, and Ruffian. He's been inducted to the Maryland Musicians Hall of Fame and plays several instruments and has acted as a frontman vocalist. Rob has written hundreds of songs in his music career and has recorded several of them. His last CD, What Is Truth, in which he has played, sang most of the instruments and all of the vocals. As first stated, he now plays in a duo group called Two of Us, and he and his bandmate Jimmy Brown have been together for 9 months in frequent shows at the Jetty, Poorhouse, Big Bats, Good Guys, Ram's Head, and special concert venues. Ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great pleasure to introduce Robert Finecey. How are you?
Take that.
Huh?
Take that. Yeah, because we don't have a lavalier on you.
Oh, I got you.
All right, so
I can hold this thing, huh?
So let's go. Let's cut to the chase. Rolling Stones or The Who? Which is your favorite?
Who?
The Who? Led Zeppelin or the Beatles?
Beatles.
Beatles? Okay. Well, we got to find out. I heard someone murmur Led Zeppelin out there. So where'd you grow up?
Baltimore City.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, okay. Southwest Baltimore.
All right. And you found your way over here when then?
1982.
Did they run you out of Baltimore, or you came over by choice?
Well, it all depends what band I was in when they ran me out.
You played in bands for a long time. I've seen some pictures on Facebook. You look considerably different, as did I back in the 80s and 70s. But you've been playing in bands a long time,
yeah.
Haven't you?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, yeah. So what was your first band?
First band, we were called the Good Vibrations.
Yeah.
Yeah, we played in our local neighborhood recital halls and stuff like that.
How many guys were in the group?
It was five of us, yeah.
Right.
I was about 13.
Were you 13?
At that time, yeah. My brother was he was 6 years older than I. He was a singer and I was a guitar player.
Right. Who was the drummer?
Billy Harrison.
Is he still around?
He's gone.
Oh, well, sorry to hear that.
That's the hurt.
Old rockers don't last forever, do it?
Nah. Yeah. You got to take care of your...
Unless you're Keith Richards. Anyway.
For real. Right?
right. So what was your earliest musical influence then? Was it your brother?
My brother, yeah.
Yeah?
Uh-huh, yeah.
Did he show you how to play the guitar?
No, he was taking lessons and everything. He was in high school, and he was taking lessons. I was in, elementary school, and he would bring his guitar home and stuff. Mm-hmm. Practice and everything, and... And then he'd say, hey, sing this part. I would sing this part and everything. And then he would leave, and I'd get his guitar and start like playing, you
right.
know, like looking at his books. And all of a sudden, I started playing like better than he was. And he was getting mad at me because why was this happening?
Right. And well, so, he didn't have the love. He just played, right?
Yeah, so I played guitar, and he sang lead.
All right.
Yeah.
Does he still, did he continue to play guitar?
Yeah, we stayed in the band probably up to about 1969.
Yeah. Okay.
And then I just went out and did my thing, you know.
So you play a number of instruments. What other instruments do you play?
I play piano, and I play drums. I play bass guitar. I play lead guitar. I play harmonica. And I would think that would be about it.
That's about enough. I can't play any one of those. Yeah. Oh, I act like I can play guitar, but don't listen to me. Uh-huh. You won't be able to identify the song. So,
big mic, man.
Yeah, well. And big guest here, Hall of Fame and all.
You know,
we got to have the right mic. We want to catch everything. So when you're playing your bands now, it's more of a subdued act now, right?
Yeah, me and Jimmy are just a lot of classics from the 60s, 70s, and 80s. We do a lot of Zeppelin.
Yeah, somebody's a Zeppelin fan.
You know what I mean? But we're like an acoustic duo. We do an acoustic duo, and we do all the stuff. You know, we do from the 60s, 70s, and 80s, all the classics. You know, it's all the vintage stuff.
So. And, You play music, you get paid a little bit of money to that. Music is your career?
No, right now my career is playing music, and I have a guitar repair shop down in Stevensville.
Is it on the main street there?
Right on Main Street, 501 Main Street.
Okay.
So I repair guitars.
Repair them?
Stuff like that.
Yeah. Do you build original guitars? Or
yeah.
Do you?
I'm working on one right now.
Okay.
Yes, I'm working on one.
All right, fantastic. So you have a love for the guitar, that's for sure. Yeah, where do you see yourself 10 years? You still playing? Or
10 years?
10 years from now, where do you see yourself?
Still playing, yeah. Still play. Yeah. Everybody, I mean, look at the Stones, man. They're like,
well, that's
way up.
I mean, well, absolutely.
Yeah. At one time, I said, you know, if I'm not famous by 28, I won't stop playing. You know?
So you're 29 now. You're gonna give it up?
Yeah, 29. Yeah, I'm 29 now. I can't give it up.
What advice, since you've been at it so long as you have, what advice would you give somebody just starting in the music business?
If anybody really believes in themselves, and they really have their instrument down, and they're a songwriter, and they really believe, don't hang around here.
Okay.
I was in Baltimore, and I mean, I was in some of the best bands in Baltimore, but you just gotta go. I said, you know, if you're a surfer, you gotta go where the waves are.
Right. So where would that be for somebody?
I would say Nashville. Right.
Nashville,
now.
That's the place
Nashville.
To go?
It's a lot of country going on in Nashville. My daughter and son-in-law, they're there and stuff, and they're in music business.
Oh, are they? They play too?
My son-in-law, he was an artist. He just stopped after 18 years, and now he's just kind of like sitting back a little bit because he wants to spend time with my grandson.
Well, that's admirable.
Yeah,
if you can do it.
You gotta get where the music is and where the people are. You know what I mean? It's good to, you know, I'm not saying it's good locally because we really were good at, we did a real good job here locally, but you. See, they're not going to come looking for you. You got to get where it's at.
Yeah. Right. So that's where it's happening now. Mm-hmm. So you just had a CD. How long ago did that CD come out?
That was in 2010.
Did you bring any to sell tonight?
No, I didn't.
No? Okay. Always bring your stuff. All right, so where can we get a copy of the CD if that's what we wanted to do?
You know, if you guys want to go to, let's go to two of us. One email, if you want to go to like twoofus.com.
Right.
And 501 Main Street.
Well, that's right, 501 Main Street. Thank you.
I have like about like 1,000 CDs there. I sold 2,000, but I got them, and I'm even dropping the price down to like $3 a piece. Oh. And they're really, really, really good. It's a good production. It took a year to do the CD.
All right. So what are your hours of operation then at 501 Main Street?
Well, I live there, so kind of like anytime you want to come by, I'll be there.
If I come out
in my pajamas, man, you'll have coffee with me. You get a CD, and if you need a guitar fixed, you know, bring your guitars down. I love messing with guitars and everything. And the main thing is like the kids are learning and stuff like that. To get them to come down and get a guitar that's fitted for them.
Okay, so less frustration factor. Right. Do you give lessons then as well?
I do give lessons.
Oh, good.
I do that too.
Okay, all right.
Anyway.
So are you working on another CD or is...
Right now, I'm a couple of those songs. That's why I had two page things here are new songs. So I don't know the words all the way yet.
You write the words first or the melody first? I've got to ask that. I've had different answers for different
guys. It's an idea. You get an idea in your head, you know, something hits you one day, and all of a sudden, you know, it just kind of comes through. You know, it comes through, and it's a melody and stuff, and you sit down and throw some words down and everything. It comes pretty fast.
You know? So you basically, then you take the music first, and then you match words to fit the music, your mood.
And vice versa, too.
Oh, okay. You do it both ways, then. Okay.
Yeah,
all right.
Sometimes the words and the music hit come
at the same time?
Yeah.
Okay.
So
all right.
Cool, yeah.
So what are you going to play for us on the last song here tonight?
I was going to do an old Beatles song.
Oh, okay.
Okay. So can't
then
do that?
You do whatever you want to do.
You know, I'm a real John Lennon fan.
Remember, don't cash that check I gave you. It ain't going to clear.
No. But I did all my songs tonight and everything. So I was going to end with a John Lennon song.
Fantastic. It's a pleasure meeting you, Rob. Why don't you have just get set up, and we'll do our goodbyes for the evening. And
and
we also have the Black Knights to come. Everybody, Rob Finecey. Well, we've had a great show tonight. We've enjoyed, of course, Rob Finecey, Thomas Walsh, Jan and her husband, Jan Withers and her husband, Joe. Sorry, Joe. I messed up there. The guys from Blackwater Distilling. We enjoyed that, hearing about that. We should probably make a visit down there and maybe go to have a sample or two in the sample room. Thank you very much, Rick and Val Colby, for allowing us to use your place, and it's much appreciated. After Rob is done, we'll have, of course, the Black Knights sing us out, but I would like to say thank you very much. I look forward to seeing you in the future, so look for further dates and information as it comes available. Thank you, Queen Anne's County Television, for coming here and film. George, it's been a wonderful experience so far, and I hope there's many more to continue. Folks, good evening. Rob, do your thing. Hold on. I forgot. So, you know what? It's St. Patrick's Day, and I forgot something very, very important. Everybody raise their glass. Everybody raise your glass. I'm sorry. Yeah, all right. St. Patrick's Day is an enchanted time, a day to begin transforming winter's dreams into summer magic. Remember that. And then finally, as we slide down the banister of life, may the splinters never point in the wrong direction. Thank you very much. Happy St. Patrick's Day. Now, Rob, after I've cut you off, go ahead.
This song was written by an Irishman from the Beatles.
Here I stand, head and high, turn my face to the wall. If she's gone, I can go on. Feeling to the tomorrow. Everywhere people stand, each and every day, I can see them laugh at me, and I hear them say,
John. You know, all the Beatles are Irish, except Ringo. Okay. Thank you, folks.
Thank you.
Well, we are the Black Knights, and we thank you for coming to our rehearsal. We usually don't have this many people for our rehearsal. First of all, I'd like to have each of the members of our group introduce themselves. James.
You gonna say something?
Oh, yes. I was telling the guys about my Irish roots, and it goes back to when I used to hang around in Hell's Kitchen in New York City.
All right.
And I used to go to the Blarney Stone, give me a couple shots of Irish whiskey, crawl out of that place, and they would look at me because I was the only brother down there. They said, who is that guy? He said, well, he works for the Santinis up the street. He said, oh, that's okay. He can come in then. We'll have your Irish whiskey, the potato, corned beef, and it was beautiful. I just wanted to relate that story.
I'm Fred.
I'm Charles.
Tom.
I'm Jack.
Yes,
sir. And I'm the other Walsh, in case you didn't know it. We're going to do something a little different this evening for our songs. We'll start off with When Irish Eyes Are Smiling. And we'll sing the chorus. And then we'll have verse one read, and then we'll re-sing the chorus, and then we'll read verse two. And we'll do the same thing with our second and closing song, Oh Danny Boy. So by the end of this, you and we should have it down pretty well. We hope.
It's okay, George, I can say it. I'm good.
So first. When Irish eyes are smiling, sure, 'tis like a morning spring. In the lilt of Irish laughter, you can hear the angels sing. When Irish hearts are happy, all the world seems bright and gay. And when Irish eyes are smiling, sure they'll steal your heart away. There's a tear in your eye, and I'm wondering why, for it never should be there at all. With such power in your smile, sure a stone you'd be glile. So there's never a hard teardrop should fall when your sweet laughter's like some fairy song. And your eyes twinkle bright as can be, you should laugh all the while and all other times smile. And now smile a smile for me.
When Irish eyes are smiling, sure 'tis like a morning spring. In the lilt of Irish laughter, you can hear the angels sing. When Irish hearts are happy, all the world seems bright and gay.
Love in your heart, and it makes even sunshine more bright. Like the linnet's sweet song, crooning all the day long, comes your laughter so tender and bright. For the springtime of youth is the sweetest of all, and is bare of real care or regret. And while springtime is ours, throughout all youth's hours, let us smile each chance we get.
When Irish eyes are smiling, sure 'tis like a morning spring. In the lilt of Irish laughter, you can hear the angels sing. When Irish hearts are happy, all the world seems bright and gay. And when sure they'll steal your heart.
Hennessy, this is for you.
Hey, Jack.
Oh, Danny boy, the pipes are calling from glen to glen and down the mountainside. The summer's gone and all the roses falling. It's you, must go and
back when summer's in the meadow, or when the valley's hushed and white with snow. It's I'll be here in sunshine or in shadow. Oh Danny boy, I love you so.
Oh Danny boy, the pipes are calling from glen to glen.
But if you come when all the flowers are dying and I am dead as I well may be, you will come and find the place where I am lying and kneel and say an Ave there for me.
Oh, Danny boy, the pipes are calling from glen to glen and down the mountainside. The summer's gone.
And I shall hear though soft you tread above me, and all my grave will warmer, sweeter be. For you will bend and tell me that you love me, and I will sleep in peace until you come to me.
Oh, Danny boy, the pipes are calling from glen to glen and down the mountainside. Summer's gone and all the roses falling. It's you, must go and I must fight.
Happy St. Patrick's Day.
All right. Yeah.